Yep, now we're back. Yeah, they haven't seen us.
Maybe.
Got it. They're not hearing it yet, but we're back.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, maybe I'm getting DDoS attacked. I would love if that was happening to me. I would feel so happy. I'd be like, I finally made it. People are angry at me. Your shit crashed? Oh, that was my shit too. Max light. Let's see. What is this question? Do you have to max up lightning fire frost resist, or is enough to have high spell resist not to get nuked down? As you know, I haven't tested that. Have you tested that? I'm sorry to see if spell resist and fire resist are two different overcharges.
I would imagine that they overcharge at the exact same spot, but each resistance builds up to that point separately. So if you have something that just gives spell resistance, like the light armor passive or the threaten passive, you know, that raises your spell resist for each of them equally. Whereas if
yeah, I think you're right.
And you've got the fire resist passive, you're going to be way ahead on fire and then equal on the other two.
Right. So having maxed out resist and then getting extra fire resist, it's just going to go into the overcharge immediately. So yeah, it's not like it's super effective in that way. Confirm dots, no crit, and please explain effects damage. There's a lot of effects, but dots, no crit.
Correct.
Some dots can. It's according to if they're a true dot or pulsating damage. Like a field that's doing damage every second can crit. A effect that's a debuff that ticks cannot, except burning, I believe, can crit. And yeah. Burning is an effect of fire damage. It's a proc chance. Some abilities have 100% chance to proc it, though. There's also... God, there's a lot of statuses. A lot. I don't think I can go through them all.
Yeah.
There's concussion, releases damage you do.
Who would want to min or max stats? Would it make the most sense to wear two pieces of heavy and five pieces of light armor? That depends entirely on what you're trying to do.
It is popular, though, to use two pieces of heavy and five pieces of light. It's very popular.
I actually have, I have switched to the 7-in-1. I'm not a big fan of. I think it seems like you get a pretty minor benefit from using twice as many skill points.
You do get a minor benefit from twice as many skill points. Yeah.
But it's yeah. I would much rather say, you know, what I'm doing is, you know, 7 pieces of heavy armor and a magicka focused race.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. The good thing about the light armor, though, as like a heavy user, is that little bit of cost reduction and regen and pierce is pretty huge, even from two pieces.
But
I think as far as using
7 medium armor, sorcerers are also very popular as well.
That's true. That's absolutely
entirely
true.
On your build.
I would say as far as getting two pieces of something goes, 5 of anything and 2 pieces of light armor. The 2 pieces of light armor, I think, give more benefit than 2 pieces of anything else.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Any host, as a sorcerer who would... Oh, you answered that.
What's your take on vampire sorcerers in PvP? Sorcerer, yes. Vampire, no.
Well, it's according to how you're building. If you look at the Tamriel Foundry, there's a new class boards for sorcerer, and one of the builds is a reaver, and I could see you working in some vampire skills into the reaver build that Atropos posted.
That said, there are so many sources of fire damage in PvP. I mean, if you go anywhere near a keep siege and they're shooting you with fire ballistas that are probably going to one-shot you as a vampire, I really have trouble seeing that being good. You know, maybe in 1v1 ganking PvP you'll do well, but once you get into the larger fights and there's dragon knights everywhere being crazy and just raping everything, or once siege comes into play almost at all, you are not going to have a good time with that fire damage.
Yeah, the stream may look laggy here. It's actually like... Actually, it shouldn't be lag as this laggy.
You know, for the Nightblade question right there, I don't see why you would need a Resto Staff as a Nightblade. Kind of their niche is that they can self-heal very well without one. So if you're looking for survivability, just put Strife on your bar. And transfer and siphoning strikes or something like that, rather than trying to keep yourself up with grad healing. Transfer gives a ultimate, not healing. You know what I mean.
Here's an interesting fact coming up. If you're one of the people that really want to know how well the system works with a huge battle on the screen, this is me recording through OBS, which actually breaks my system resources, while in ultra graphics with like 200, 300 people on the screen coming up. So it'll be an interesting thing to see. It's a huge Zerg fight is what it is, in a very big choke point. Rose, does Templar skills do more damage to vampires? Only fiery abilities. So only Vampire's Bane currently.
And the other board. I saw an interesting one there before it gets away. Can either of us talk about skills that use stamina and medium armor? You know, a lot of talk has been around magic. I personally think that magic is a lot more popular because, well, for one, there's a lot of good magic abilities available early on through the class skills. But
yeah, your class skills are sort of important, I think, and that's why a lot of people go that route.
I think you can make medium armor stamina builds that work well, but you're probably still going to want to have class abilities that kind of complement that, like haste for a Nightblade or critical surge for a sorcerer.
You're going to want to go magicka buffs, that way your magicka is not so like resource intensive. But I will say, Benefactor is a stamina build, and I've seen him absolutely trash people. You can actually watch Angry Joe's video on PvP, and you see Benefactor pop around a corner and like two-shot him, and it's hilarious because Angry Joe's like, wow, that guy just fucked me up. It's really funny. Also, Valentina, another ER member, he has a stamina build that seems to work out pretty well. He even does a decent amount of AoE with it. I was kind of surprised with his acid spray cone bow attack. So I think it can work. You just gotta build it just right. I think Atropos' Reaver build on the Sork actually is a Sork stamina build as well, with full medium armor and everything.
That's how I read it, yeah.
Yeah, I believe
although
it is.
He didn't specifically say it, it seems like it'd be better that way.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is. I've seen him play it. And it's actually really effective. He has a lot of healing and a lot of damage, single target. It's pretty effective.
So the question I really want to talk about now is Chojin83. He asked, from a min-maxing point of view, what do you think would be a better race for a stamina, magic-based DBS Templar, Bowen two-handed, Breton or Imperial? And I really like this because this is my exact build, and I'm considering both of those two races, and I have no fucking idea what I'm going to do. So what do you think?
I missed that question. I was reading something else. What was it?
God damn it.
Sorry, what was the question?
From a min-maxing point of view, what do you think would be a better race for a stamina magicka-based DPS Templar, Bowen two-handed, Breton, or Imperial? Breton was my initial choice, I'll say. But with the recent change to give Templars
wait, you're going to go you're gonna go stamina and magicka?
I'm going to go mostly magicka, but, using Bowen two-handed and using the Warrior Stone, I'm going to be relying on stamina abilities somewhat.
I would go Dunmer. I'll throw a thing out there. They get bonus to magicka and... They get magicka and stamina bonus, though. So, that's kind of useful. They also get fire damage, which isn't bad on a Templar by any means, with Vampire's Bane.
And I do use Vampire's Bane in all of my loadouts, so that is helpful. But between the two, I think Breton looks really good with the magic focus, and magic resist is nice, but... that extra stamina and health would really help and let you focus on magicka. And those 12% buffs are
huge.
Yeah,
Breton would probably as well as I would go.
I use Degeneration from the Mage's Guild now to give me some extra healing. And I think that 15% chance to heal for weapon damage done might complement the Imperial.
It would. Yeah, there's
nicely?
Benefits to both. There's benefits to both, it really is. I saw a question, was probably asking because of me talking about the big, huge fight. You can see my PC specs below my stream. I think it's called PC specs. But it's a GTX 770 with an i7 2600K overclocked to 4.0. And that's like all the important stuff, basically. And I also run on a 2560 by 1440 monitor, so that actually makes it much harder to run.
One more thing with the races that's worth considering is that, especially with the Breton racials, there's nothing there that you can't get from another source, whether it's, you know, putting magic on your gear, you know, getting...
That's true.
Well, actually, Reinforce doesn't give that anymore. Yeah, but, you know, you can enchant for magic resistance if you want, and like we said earlier, you're probably going to hit that cap anyway. They recently changed Restoring Spirit to where it doesn't give... Magicka back when you cast an ability. It's just a 4% reduction to all spell Magicka stamina and ultimate costs,
which sucks.
I'm not flipping tables over that anymore. Yeah, I'm close. So I'm not going to talk about that change much longer because it's fucking terrible.
I'm pretty flip the table worthy on that one. I'm not happy about it.
Yeah, it was bad. Yesterday, I would have ranted for a good 15 minutes about that change. But I don't know. I think there's just, you know, he says Breton, and I think Breton would be a, you know, probably one of the top two choices. But Imperial also gives you nice benefits to the non-magic stats that you're probably not focusing on so much with your gear, and red crystals, which you can't get from gear. So there's a compelling argument to be made either way.
How valuable are spell resists in PvP? Is it worth taking a Breton just for the addition? I would not say it's worth it to go Breton just for the spell resist, but I will say that they're very important. But I don't think it's that worth it. Because you can get them other places.
Spell resist is very important, but, you know, I mean, yeah, you can get it so many places, and you'll probably pretty easily...
The thing with spell resist, too...
Cap, especially if you're in light armor.
Yeah, well, heavy armor gets a bonus, too. I would, so.
Yeah, that's true. That is true. It's not as good, though, right?
It's about half as effective, but it's still pretty decent.
Yeah. I wouldn't let that be your deciding factor, but Gift of Magnus, the 10% magic buff, is pretty damn big. And cost reduction is a favorite of mine.
Quirrell, how did they change Restoring Spirit again? Didn't catch that. They changed it from being 4% mana, your total magic gained every time you use an ability, to being 4% reduced cost for all abilities, including ultimates, which is, it may sound like, oh, that's not that bad. It's really bad. Like, it went from gaining like 100 magicka every time you casted a spell to now spells cost like 10 less. So it's a pretty huge nerf.
Enormous nerf. Yeah, it's really horrible. Part of why we're bitching right now so much is that Magicka Regen was broken with this patch, so it seems a lot worse than it is in practice. So once we fix that, they fix that, maybe we'll be less table flippy about it.
Yeah, but, I think they still need to buff the new.
It's still pretty bad.
Ability. Yeah, I think it needs to be like easily. 10%.
Yeah, it needs to be on par with those sorcerer abilities. If they made it 10% in a 3-point passive, I think that would be a better thing too.
I'd be happy with a 10% and a 2-point passive 5/5.
Oh yeah, I mean I'd be happy with it. But,
I mean it's like the last ability, right? Yeah, it's the level 51. Yeah. I think it should be pretty strong.
And it is pretty garbage right now. So.
Yeah, this is recorded footage. I can just skip around on it.
That extra spell damage for a Dark Elf playing a DK is, you know, pretty damn good, because most of what they do is fire damage. I definitely think that's significant.
If you're thinking about damage dealing DK, I would say Dunmer is a great choice. Plus, Dunmer get major style points because they look cool. Someone... Cactaw, what question are you asking about? That's the question that you just answered. How good spell damage is fire damage? Yeah, it's really good. Very, very good. Do you think the soft caps are going to get a little tweaking before now and launch? I think they'll get some tweaking. I don't think they'll get a lot, though. I think they have a pretty good idea of where they want your stats to be around for current content. And I think that's where they sort of put the soft caps at. What is most viable, magic damage or melee damage for a DK? If you're talking about magical damage or physical damage, I would say magical, but all of their magical damage is melee range. So,
And I would say that, I mean, that's kind of, if you're using shared abilities, you'll do just fine doing physical damage, you know, with stamina. But if you're saying, what are you going to do better with the DK class abilities? Well, yeah, it's going to be Magicka.
Yeah, and I would say overall, for like melee range build, I would go heavy on their abilities, because like their fire dots are pretty strong. And
their everything is pretty strong. Yeah,
their fire damage is pretty strong.
The light armor, spiked armor, Dragonite is a pretty big no-brainer.
Yeah, I think it's pretty OP, you know, and all things considered. That's how I would build a DK. I would be light armor with like I'd probably use spiked armor with light armor and dark talons and like your slash dot thing and lava whip. So I would be like a magical, decently tanky melee build. And I think that would be really strong.
Yeah, you know, someone in here is complaining about the subscription fee. You know, if free-to-play MMOs are your thing, then go play a free-to-play MMO. It's a different type of game for a different type of people.
Yeah,
I agree. Think all of us 100%. Here prefer subscription MMOs. They're way, way better.
Yeah, with the subscription, you're not paying to be able to play the game. You're paying to get the new stuff they're going to come out with next month. And that's the thing you have to remember.
And you're paying for, you know, better support, you know, not having Candy Crush-style design where they're trying to drag money out of you every 2 seconds. I don't play free-to-play games.
It's horrible. Here's a great way to explain.
You know, people are dropping in and out constantly. Yeah, so if you want a persistent community like an MMO really should be, you're never going to get that with a free-to-play game.
Yeah, and here's the thing. You got to think of it in the terms of developers and money, because it's a business. All things considered, it's a business. And when it's a free-to-play game, their money comes from you buying things. So their paycheck, which means their livelihood, comes from making things that want to make you spend money on. That's a fact. That's a fact. There's no way around that. They want you to spend more money. So they're going to come up, they're going to spend their resources in coming up with ways to make you spend money. At least $15 a month in order to keep the game running. Whereas, on the other side of things, they already know you're going to pay $15 a month. Their only job... Wait, did I just lose TeamSpeak? Oh, TeamSpeak just dropped. But their only job in a sub game is to make the game better and keep you playing it. So all the resources go to making the game more fun to play. And that's the difference.
Hey, wake up. User was moved to your channel.
Yeah, TeamSpeak crashed there for a second. We're back, though.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, somebody said, I don't know if I started responding to this or not, what if the price was lower? And I think that's very unrealistic to expect. You know, MMOs have been $15 a month for the last 15 years or so since they started.
Which actually means they have gotten cheaper.
A lot of inflation since then. So the actual price, inflation adjusted, would be in the low 20s, I think, per month. So, you know, saying to lower the price from what every MMO has ever done for no reason is, you know, completely nonsensical.
Yeah, it is lowered. This is the lowered price. They could have charged $20.
Especially when we're more demanding of content now.
Yeah, and Limdul, yeah, it is a lot like a heretic in, like, a melee tick. What was it called? A melee heretic, yeah. That's how I would play it. I think it would be good that way.
I haven't heard anything about an Argonian getting a racial buff, unless you mean just what their racials are.
I'm saying that they will get a racial buff, because Zenimax knows how useless swim speed is. They are well aware. They're going to fix that. They're going to change to something.
Let's give them a swim speed buff when they're you can't swim without getting killed in the water in Cyrodiil. That's a great idea.
Yeah, like they know that that's a problem. They just haven't found something to replace it with yet. And I think they will before launch. The same thing with Breton. Not Breton. Bosmer. Yeah, I think they know that Bosmers aren't a good option. Like, for a fact, Zenimax developers read the Tamriel Foundry. And when we put an article out that says these two races are worse than every other race in every way, they know that we think that, and then everyone else knows that because they know how many people read TF articles, so they're going to change it. They'll get buffed. It's just a matter of time.
Connection lost.
And TeamSpeak is down again. Connected.
User was moved to your channel.
I think Atropos is fucking with us. Is rune focus, channeling focus any good? If it's situational, when is it good to use? That's the ultimate that heals, right?
Mm-mm.
Rune focus?
No, the ultimate's terrible. Rune focus, I think, is the mark on the ground that gives you the armor buff.
Oh, that one is not good in PvP, I would say, because it's rare that you're that stationary. It's a better PvE ability.
And I have used it when I was soloing some low-level dungeons that, I guess they were like level 30 dungeons, which was really hard. And I've used it to great effect there.
It's good in PvE.
Really well.
Yeah, it's good in PvE. I used it when tanking veteran dungeons on my Templar and Cloth Armor in any boss that didn't have a whole lot of movement, especially bosses that had that were magical, so they stayed in one's place a lot. It was great because you just casted it there at your feet and you knew you were going to be in it, and it gave a huge, huge buff.
I see a lot of people use Ring of Preservation, which is a Fighter's Guild AoE that increases armor for spell resistance and health regeneration.
Yeah, that's
a
good one too.
It's much bigger. So if you're looking for sort of a, you know, Guild Wars 2 Guardian style big buff on the ground, that's probably the way you're looking.
Yeah, that's the better PvP choice. It's a bigger radius, it's easier to stay in, and it works on other people. I'd say we're a decent way through our stream, so I'll go ahead and do my self-plug in the middle, and you can do yours too, Asari. If you're enjoying the stream so far, please click the follow button under the stream. That will let you know when I stream again, and that's all I really ask from my viewers, is to hit the follow button. If you enjoy the stream, hit the follow button. It's really simple. So if you guys don't care, do that.
User was moved to your channel.
Now, sorry, you can do your self-plug.
What am I plugging?
Yourself. Twitter's whatever.
Oh, okay. My Twitter is at Sir Asari, SIRISARII, because my name was taken. TamrielFoundry.com. Go there, obviously. That's pretty much it. Legend-gaming.net for guild stuff. We are the EP. It's great.
Yeah, if you're a good player, that's a good guild. They're going to be big in Cyrodiil, I think, Vokendine, so look them up.
Yeah, if you don't want to play a filthy elf, come on by.
Or if you do want to, you pre-ordered.
that's true, yeah, now we have filthy elves in our factions, so.
Okay, but back to the questions. Thank you for everyone who followed. Plugging yourself is on a different canvas site. It's a good point.
God.
That's a good point. You won't be seeing me on that one.
I was answering the bubble question before I got disconnected again. Yes, that's called Siege Shield. It reduces damage taken from siege attacks and ranged attacks while you're in it.
It's a great ability. Great ability. You'll see it used here. Is that what they're... They probably did see it used here. Yeah, you'll probably see it used here. Oh, yeah, that's what he was talking about. Yeah, it does a lot less damage from siege and ranged attacks. How hard does Dawnbreaker hit werewolves and dead danger targets level 50? Real goddamn hard. That's how hard. As hard as you would expect. Real hard.
Connection lost. Connected.
Yeah, something's happening with our TeamSpeak. I'm not sure what's going on, so... pertaining to soft caps, at what point with attributes does it cut off before it gets hard capped? How does gear enchant points factor in? With attributes, I haven't seen a hard cap yet. So, I don't know. It goes up pretty high. It starts overcharging at like 1850 or something, and I'm like over 2000 and I haven't hit a hard cap yet on Magicka. So, it's fairly high above it.
User was moved to your channel.
Did Atropos have any insight into what's going on?
Apparently we're still on the old TF server, so he's looking at moving us to the new one.
Oh, okay. Would a Dunmer be a good choice for a two-hand Bosork or maybe a Redguard? Two-hand Bosork, I would not go Dunmer. They don't have a whole lot of magic or fire damage there, and that's their big benefit. I would go Redguard. If out of the two, I go Redguard.
Hi, Samurai 7 Gamer. We really can't list all the soft cap values. I don't actually have those numbers. I don't know if you do, but I mean, it would take forever, and some of them are hidden.
They're on Tamriel Foundry, I believe. I believe Phasius made a post. I don't know where, but you can find it.
Ah.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Yep, mascot linked.
There we go. He knows more than us.
Yep. Is the DK skill of Searing Strike as overpowered as Isohead suggests? No, it's not overpowered. It's just strong. It's a good damaging dot attack. It's really cheap, though. Really cheap.
Is the Nightblade good for a large stamina pull? Nightblades are never good.
A little early game footage. Oh, did you get kicked out again, Azari? Oh, no, you're not.
It Where hung for a second.
Oh, that's weird.
I guess I reconnected early enough this time.
Hmm. We could always move into the lobby and just talk in there.
Yeah, let's move to something else I can get into.
Yeah, if you get disconnected again, I'll just meet you wherever you come in.
Alright.
How good is the Breton's Dragon Skin Ultimate? That doesn't exist anymore. Yeah. I think those will make a comeback later. I think you'll see that in a patch. Post-launch patch. That's just rampant speculation, but I think you will.
You know, I don't see dots getting cleansed that frequently in PvP, honestly. In a Zerg where they're spamming
in a Zerg
ritual, it happens, but I don't think it's that big of a deal.
I think you'll see it in really organized groups more often because it's sort of harder to cleanse them. But I think it'll be useful to do that because I think there's a lot of powerful dots. So, I don't know. That's sort of a meta that we'll have to see how it evolves.
We're not showing first-person gameplay because we're good at the game.
Actually, I am. I do have
Are
game.
You really?
I have first-person footage in this one, and I recorded this specifically because it was so easy and low level that I could actually tolerate it in first-person.
Oh yeah. I remember when you were doing that. Okay, yeah. We do have some first-person footage.
Yeah. So
at,
here you go.
Like the
and
level
this,
two point. Of
and
the
this
game,
is with
that's
collision.
The only time you should be doing it.
Yeah, and this is with collision now in the game. If no one knew that, there is collision against mobs in ESO now. To give more weight behind things. You'll notice a lot of these mobs, I purposely run into them, so you'll see that I stop.
And also because you can't tell where you're standing when you're in first-person mode.
Yeah, that too. A couple times I swing and I'm not nearly close enough to them. I cannot imagine ZeniMax will let Nightblades remain to be underpowered forever. What will it take to bring them on par with other classes? Can you see them being anything other than 1v1 DPS classes?